about a single file diffusion, the exclusion process is going to play an important role. So you know everything now about the exclusion process tends to seem wrong. But let's start again. So I think this is the morning or the day for statistical physics. So the motivation to understand this type of models is now strongly rooted in non-equilibrium statistical mechanics. And this is a picture with some homotopy that everybody draws in the community. It's a pipe which is in connection with two different reservoirs, which can be at different temperatures, different potentials, or different chemical potentials, different densities. And if you wait long enough, then you will have a steady state current which will flow from higher to lower temperature, higher to lower density, and it will fluctuate. And we want to understand what's happening in the microscopic level and try to deduce some macroscopic laws. So in the extreme case, let's take the temperature metaphor, but it could be densities. When the two reservoirs are identical at the same temperature, we have equilibrium statistical mechanics. And we know everything about it. We have all these Gibbs ensembles, we know how to study thermodynamics, potentials, calculate them using Maxwell-Boltzmann, also get the fluctuations, which are generically Gaussian, phase diagram, phase transitions, whatever. It's a whole field, of course. But the temperatures, or the densities, are slightly different, so the relative difference is small with respect to the absolute value, then, of course, you will have a stationary current in a long-time limit, but you can use linear response theory, which means first order perturbation around thermodynamic equilibrium to get some results. For example, you can compute the conductivity of this system for small difference of voltages by using the Kubo formula, which is a kind of avatar of the Einstein formula, which relates transport coefficients, conductivity, resistivity, and so on, with fluctuations at equilibrium. Dissipation theorem allows you to extract transport coefficients near equilibrium, knowing equilibrium fluctuations. By the way, this is the whole set, the whole field of non-equilibrium thermodynamics, but one has to remind that it's close to equilibrium, in fact, it's really linear response. And for example, Prigogine's school in Belgium has reformulated all that in terms of entropic production rate. One should keep in mind that when you have a current which is flowing, let's get an electric current, then because of Fourier, you generate heat in your... So you're generating heat, so your entropy is increasing all the time. So you cannot use entropy as a potential, because it's not constant. So at best, you can use entropy production rate, but this is useful only in the vicinity of equilibrium. If you go far from equilibrium, so now the two reservoirs are very different, they are very different temperatures, we are beyond linear regime, you cannot use classical results in statistical mechanics, which are valid only in the vicinity of equilibrium, so you have to go further and do something else. So in this context, one minimal model, which was investigated in our field first by Katz, Leibowitz, and Spohn in the 80s, but which was invented before by a mathematician, is the so-called asymmetric exclusion process, ASAP, which is a set of random walkers on a lattice, which can be asymmetric, so they jump preferably in one direction and with lesser rate to the previous one. But they are not independent. They satisfy an exclusion constraint, a purely classical, nothing to do with Pauli. The fact is that a particle, it's in continuous time, cannot jump to a site which is already occupied. So this interaction makes it into a non-trivial n-body problem. So it has become a paradigm in the field. It's a kind of minimal model, but it's rich enough to allow for some interesting results, hopefully. So the main thing is at most one particle per site at a given time. This exclusion condition makes ASAP into a genuine n-body system. The fact that the jumps are asymmetric, or there are some boundaries which have different potentials or different densities on the left and on the right, this generates a non-equilibrium current in the system. So it's a driven system. and it's not out of equilibrium. It's not reversible, it does not satisfy detailed balance. And finally, it's just a process. There is no Hamiltonian, it's just a stochastic Markovian process. And there is no Hamiltonian, there's no even a way to attempt to define anything like a Gibbs measure. There's no H, so how can you write exponential minus beta H anyway? So it's a paradigm, and it's also a building block in many more realistic models, for example in biophysics. As long as you have one-dimensional transport and that geometric constraints, exclusion constraints are important, this model pops out. Going backwards. So let's come a bit into the Rocky subject. The nice thing is that AZ is integrable. So again, what is the exclusion process? It's just a set of particles on the lattice. So a state at a given time is just given by the occupation numbers at different points of the lattice. So it's a collection, a numerical collection of binary variables. Eta x of t is 0 or 1 if site x is empty or occupied at time t. And the evolution is given, it's a Markov, continuous time Markov system. So it's given by a generator or Markov matrix, call it as you like. It's an infinite matrix here because we are on the infinite line. And you can write it formally like that. It just means that at site x, a particle present can jump at site x plus 1 with rate b, or a particle at site x plus 1 can jump at x with rate q, and this tells you how the system varies between time t and t plus dt. So I imagine that most of the community are not probabilists, although there are some here. So this is not a familiar way of writing, but you see that this Markov matrix is made of local blocks which act on bounds between x and x plus 1, what's happening. And in fact, this thing, instead of using binary variables, you can rewrite it using spin variables, plus or minus 1/2. And in fact, this part is exactly equivalent to a local update operator in a non-Hermitian spin chain that you can also transform, if you wish, locally into an XLC model. So in fact, AZ is an imaginary or real-time version of the XLC spin chain, but remind that it's not Hermitian. So in fact, if you want to transform it into XLC, you have to use a non-unitary change of variables. So the fact that the exclusion process is an integrable non-Hermitian spin chain is a remarkable, something that Dipakdar and then Goa and Spohn realized in the end of the 80s and beginning of 90s. So it has a rather long story. But they are also beyond integrability, or thanks to integrability, some very deep combinatorial properties which are very useful to understand the world. We have seen some of them in Sylvain's talk just now ago. So the thing is, the message is that integrability methods can be used, or sometimes generalized, to answer some relevant questions in non-equilibrium statistical mechanics, which are not exactly always the same observables that people compute for XLC, for XLC spin chains. So it can be a bit different, but of course it's highly related. So that was a general introduction. I will tell you about the problem we want to study in this today's talk, which is the tracer statistic in the exclusion process, in the symmetric exclusion process. The second part will be technical, maybe not as technical as the previous talk, but still, hopefully a bit technical. It's about integrable probabilities. So I will go into the details. I will really try to trace out the different steps of the calculations, because there are some interesting mathematical and combinatorial tricks at different steps. And in the end, if I have some little time, this would have been the whole talk in some other place, but I will try to draw some physical consequences, less technical but more recreative consequences about the exclusion process. Anyway, so exact tracer statistics. So there is a general phenomenon which is called single file diffusion, which is shown in these pictures. If you have small particles which are flowing mostly in one dimension, they get a bit scattered around, in a tube which is quite thick, and if you look at one particle, it will diffuse normally in square root of t. But now, if there are some macromolecules which are traveling in a very thin capillary vessel, and they are so thick that they cannot pass over each other, they have to conserve their order, and you monitor the position of one of them, you will see that it will diffuse very slowly. It will diffuse in fourth root of time. Okay, so the square of the position, fluctuations of the position are in square root of t, whereas in the normal Brownian motion, the square of the average position is linear in time. So this is called single file anomalous diffusion. And of course, as I showed you, the symmetric exclusion process where particles can jump in both directions but are not allowed to occupy the same site and therefore keep their order relative to each other is the pristine model for understanding this kind of physical phenomenon, which is seen in the labs, by the way. And that's exactly what I'm showing here. There's a person in Stuttgart, Leichinger, who likes to play with small individual molecules and to build small vessels. So he really built a small cylinder in which only one grain particle can fit in, and so they have to keep their Indian file, their single file order. And if he makes the thing thicker, larger, then of course they can overtake each other, and you have no diffusion. He has really measured all these things and obtained some nice experimental results. So now let's forget about the physics and let's go to the model. So we are on Z, on the integers positive and negative, the full lattice. We consider the symmetric exclusion process. We take a particle and we look at it. So of course, because of symmetry, on average its position is zero. If the particle were allowed to pass over each other, it would be just independent of workers, and the square of x in average would be linear in time with a diffusion constant. But because of the exclusion condition, in fact, in the Z symmetric exclusion process, the square average, the average of the square of the position of a given particle only grows as square root of t, and in fact there is an exact calculation at dominant order in the long time limit, which was already performed 30 years ago, 40 years ago almost, by Yahatia. So this is a mathematical result. And in the mathematical community, quite a few people have been working on this issue. So this is really the exact asymptotics. But up to the recent years, this was the only thing which was known about the tracer statistics. For example, there were no formula for higher moments of this tracer. One mathematical result quite strong by Setorama and Baratan in 2013 was that the position of a tracer satisfied a so-called large deviation principle, which is also a framework which is quite now popular in non-Kirone statistical mechanics. It means, by hand-waving, that the probability distribution of your tracer concentrates in the long time limit. There's a concentration of the measure, and you can measure the concentration of the measure by some exponential rate. And the rate of this concentration is called the large deviation function. Just in one word, the reason that people are interested in non-Kirone statistical mechanics in these large deviation functions is that many people are now quite convinced that these are the right objects to generalize the potentials, the thermodynamic potentials, far from equilibrium. As I told you, out of equilibrium, entropy loses its meaning because it's always growing, so it's no use. But it seems that large deviation functions are the right objects, and all the more that they identify with thermodynamic potentials when you go back to the equilibrium real. When you approach equilibrium, these large deviation functions become identical to the free energy, the entropy, the Gibbs energy, and so on. So Setorama and Varadan were able to prove the existence of this function, to get some bounds for it, but they didn't compute it. It's not their goal, and they didn't get its expression. Another open question is that what's the influence of the initial setting? I was telling you of the simple example with uniform density at t equal to 0, but you could start with two different densities, which is more interesting. You could start with an asymptotic density rho plus when x is large, and rho minus when x is small, so step profile. How does it influence the motion of the tracer? And of course, all this is at large time, but the exact finite time distribution of a given particle was not known. Another thing which has not been explored much is the asymmetric case, for example, the Tazep case. So Tazep is normal, not a general asymmetry. So the problem we want to solve is the following. We start with Z. There's a particle at initial time which is at zero, at box zero. Particles hop with same rates, one towards the left and on the right. And the initial condition is the so-called Bernoulli, two-half Bernoulli initial condition, which means that you occupy independently at initial time the sides to the right with probability rho plus, and not occupied with one minus rho plus, and probability rho minus to the left. So you create a step, you put a particle at zero, and you want to know, the goal of the talk is to determine the statistics of the position of the tracer, and if possible at any time, and to extract the asymptotics and the large deviations and the cumulants at long time. So, okay, I decided to do a kind of math type talk. So I give you the result. So that is, things are clear, and then we shall try to understand how these results are obtained. So there is an exact formula for the finite time distribution of the tracer. So we know what is the probability that the position of the tracer at time t is less than any x, and it's given by the integral with some decoration of a Fredholm determinant. So it's an integral over a small contour, c0, which does not contain the singularities of the kernel of the operator we want to compute the determinant, the Fredholm determinant of. So this is an operator with a kernel, and the kernel of two variables is given by this expression, which should remind you of the xxx form factor. Of course, we shall see why. There is, as usual in the Fredholm determinant, there is a parameter in front of your kernel. This parameter is given in terms of the initial densities on the left and on the right. And of course, it depends also on the z variable you're integrating upon. And there is an extra factor which multiplies your Fredholm determinant, which contains the initial condition also, which is decoupled from the rest. Okay. So this variable omega, which plays an important role, is something which appears in many calculations of Z and in the exclusion process, because it embodies some fundamental symmetries of the model by particle and hole exchange and time reversal. This kernel, we shall talk a lot about it, is inspired from the better results. And this function omega zero contains this Poisson-like initial condition. Okay, so that's the complete result. And from this, we can extract many, many things. But I think everybody knows, Fredholm determinant is just, you know, you have this classical formula for a finite matrix. We know that the first order perturbation of the determinant is a trace, but the second order is 2 by 2 minors and 3 by 3. And if you go to the continuous limit, all these sums become integrals, and you define the Fredholm determinant by this iterative series. Okay. So one big difficulty, first difficulty in the problem, is that particles are moving. So your tracer, the observable of the position of the tracer, is not localized in your system. It's just wandering about, so it's going far. And it's easier to deal with local observables. So there is one first trick, and we saw an avatar of the trick in Sylvain's talk, is that it's better to talk in terms of height or current variables. So they are defined as follows, and configuration of the exclusion process, which is made of 0 and 1s, occupied and t sites, you can just first encode it by an interface. If you have no particle, you take horizontal line, and if you have one particle somewhere, you draw a 45 degree upper slope line. So this interface, unless I made a mistake, should encode for this configuration of particles. But of course you have to know at which height, global height, you put your interface. Okay, because I could have drawn it here or upper. So the important thing is that the height, the absolute height over size zero, in fact this height is equal to the total current which has flown through this bond between time zero and t. And the total current in this talk, because this is a convention that mathematicians like and physicists hate, but we took the mathematician's convention, current is counted positively when you jump to the left and negatively when you jump to the right.
Okay. So you have only finitely many
particles? No, I have an infinite number of particles, which are given by Bernoulli, rho plus and rho minus, but I could draw only a finite number of them.
Yeah, but the total current is not very infinite?
No, at time equal to zero, I have a zero current to this bond, and now I'm counting.
You start counting from
t equal to zero.
Okay.
Yeah. And zero t represent the total current through that bound in the duration from 0 to t. Okay. And the rest is just fixed by configuration at time t. The relation with the KPC height that we heard in Sylvain's talk is just a small shift with respect to that. But this quantity n is more handy for what we want to do here. Okay, so now, I'm going to tell you something which is very easy, but it's impossible for me to explain it all the more in English. But even in French, is that if you think about it, because the particles are not allowed to overtake each other, the fact that a given particle, the tracer, which starts at zero, at t equal to zero, and moves, the probability that the tracer moves more than x steps, okay, it has to push all the particles which are between him and position x, it implies that the current inside x has to obey some constraint, okay, just by counting, you know, the exclusion condition. It's very easy if I just give you the condition. The probability that the tracer moves further than x, because of the convention of counting positively what goes to the left, is equal to the probability that the height x at time t is negative or zero. Okay. Again, very easy, but annoying to explain in details, or equivalent, you can just do. Change the upper and smaller and bigger signs. So the statistical properties of the tracer, which is a moving variable, and those of the height nxt, which is a local observable, are related. The only problem that instead of having now one random variable x of t to deal with, now I have to deal with all the heights over all the sites at a given time. But they are local observables. Okay. So the thing is that once I have this relation, if I can extract full information about this random variable, I can deduce full information about the tracer position. So now we focus on these tight random variables. And the result is, which implies the first result I gave you, the result which we are going to prove is that the exponential generating function, so the average of exponential lambda n, which is nothing but the Laplace transform of the probability distribution of n at time t, is given by this Fredon determinant, the same as before, multiplied by the same function, which takes into account the initial conditions. Okay. So that's the main result, and now I will give you the strategy to get to the result, to solve the problem. So solving the problem involves the so-called integrable probabilities. I think this is a term which was coined by Corbin and Borodin to talk about probabilistic problems which can be solved using the design methods, and this is a kind of typical problem where you can use these methods. So first, it will prove useful to generalize slightly the tracer problem and to consider asymmetric jumps. So the same problem, the same variables, but now for an asymmetric exclusion process where particles jump to the right with probability range P, and to the left with range Q. And because of my convention, I take Q to be bigger than P. So we have now one more handle, one more parameter to play with, which is the asymmetry ratio, which is P over Q, which is less or equal to 1 in the symmetric case, strictly less than 1 in the asymmetric case. Okay. So as I told you just before, we have traded this moving tracer position random variable for the local height variables, but now we have an infinite number, a numerical infinite number of them to deal with simultaneously. And one thing we need to do to be able to get some results is to restore finiteness. So although we have an infinite number of particles, we need to do some finite calculations to get exact results at finite time and combinatorial results. Okay, so how do we do that? This is an important property which is true for the asymmetric exclusion process. So it's true as soon as tau is strictly less than 1, but not for tau equal to 1. It is a duality property. So, to state it in a formal way, what we would have the natural tendency to consider are correlators for these height variables, and x1t, and x2t, and xkt. But these objects do not satisfy good equations, they are just messy. But instead of considering the correlators between n, if we consider tau to the power nx1 times tau to the power nxk or nx small nt, these tau deformed endpoint functions, they satisfy a very good dynamics. In fact, so this is duality, maybe we are going to hear about it in Roman Frasek's talk, at least he worked a lot on that. These correlators satisfy a set of closed equations, and which are exactly the same equations as the ones for the asymmetric exclusion process with only n particles. Okay. So this is duality, because we start from a problem which has an infinite number of particles, but some correlators in this problem satisfy the same equations as the finite same problem, finite AZ with n particles. So this duality, if I was talking in the first half of the week, I would try to learn to explain to you why it really results from a SU2Q invariance of the AZ. And this was really understood by Schultz at the beginning, and then there were works of Imamura, Sasauto, and then Giardina, Frasek, Gorshan, and other people. I think also Tomohiro was working with them for a while. What happened is that we understood the same thing without using the quantum group, but in a more probabilistic way. And this is the one I'm going to explain to you in one slide. So I'm going to prove duality using Poisson calculus. Just for one particle, but the proof is the same if you take multiple correlators. So if you take just one average correlator and you try to see how it evolves between time t and t plus dt, so you just write the difference, and the difference will come only if you have a jump through the side x between t and t plus dt. So you can really quantify the variation of the height at bound x by looking at different cases. Either particle jumps to the right, so this thing is equal to 1, it's equal to 2 minus 1, or it jumps to the left, it jumps to the left, so this thing is equal to plus 1, and it's tau minus 1, or it jumps to the right, this thing is minus 1, so it's 1 minus tau, and you can compute the probabilities. To jump to the left, well, it has jumped from x plus 1 to x, so x plus 1 has to be occupied and x has to be empty, and so on. And then you just play with these different cases, you plug them back into this difference. And because we are talking about binary variables, it's very easy to just exponential them. Yeah. Okay. You just write a little linear combination instead of eta, you can talk about tau to the power eta and just add or subtract what you need. And you immediately see that the variation of this one-body correlator just does what a single particle would do in the asymmetric exclusion process. Either it jumps to the right with tau rate 1, or to the left with tau, and so on and so on. So this one-body correlator obeys the dynamics of a single particle under Hesek dynamics, and two particles correlator will be the evolution of two particles, k particle correlators will be the evolution of k as a particle. So it's in fact very simple. But again, you probably like it better, it really comes from quantum invariance of the world. Okay. Now, now that we know that we have a finite particle exclusion process which is underlying our correlators, we can try to solve it because Hesek is integrable. And to solve it, we can take inspiration from the fact that Hesek is better than that integrable. But we are not really going to use the better than that as a whole point. And we can write the tau correlator average as a multiple integral in the complex plane. I'm not going to go into the details of this simple formula, but you can recognize things. This kind of form factor just embodies the, you know, the usual things in better ones as the two scattering, two-body scattering matrix. This is just the free evolution for a given particle, z to the power x, when we write the better on that. Okay, we need some other variables to put rho plus and rho minus, but it's not important. Theta plus or minus, r plus or minus, just encode for the densities on the right and on the left. And the whole thing is that this integral is in the complex plane on some, sorry for the picture, which is not so nice here, on some nested contours in the complex plane. So now the whole point to understand is that you can just say that this formula pops out from nowhere, which is not true, because it's inspired by better results, but it's not a better result. It's an exact formula. These are not fugacities. They are integration dummy variables, so they do not satisfy any better equation. There are no better equations. It's just an exact representation of the k-body, n-body, tau correlator of your exclusion process. And the way to check it is just to prove that it satisfies the dynamical equation. So it's one body, I could have written the k-body dynamical equation with the correct boundary conditions. So you just take this formula and you check that it satisfies the master equation with the correct initial conditions. So again, the structure helps. You have some very simple identities for these rational fractions, which kill some poles, and then puff, you get zero. Satisfies the master equation. And the initial condition at t equal to zero is checked by a residue calculation. So integrability is important. These contour integral formulas are, of course, were initially inspired by the better on that. But to mimic what Tracy Guidon say in one of their papers, it's better on that without on that. So it's better alone. Because they are exact representations of the correlators, I say again, the I's are dummy variables. They are not better roots, there are no better equations. Okay, here. And as you could have noticed, there is no sum over permutation in this formula. It's just an integral. But somehow the sum of the permutations is taken into account by these nesting conditions on the contours that I didn't tell you about. You just take 2-3 lines to be written, but somehow you have to nest from z1 to zn, and the poles for a smaller k, for larger k, have to be included in the contour for smaller zk.
There are some representations like this for the scalar products, the formula that by Ivan that was mentioned earlier. Looks very much like
it. Yes, and in our community, this really goes back to Schultz, who started the game already in 1995, I think. 20 years ago. But of course, yeah. So.
Another question. So, I missed a point. So, is it possible to obtain this formula from tracing medium formula?
No.
No.
No. As you probably know, there are plenty of small, as we say, the devil is hidden in the details. Tracing medium formulas are valid only for Bernoulli zero row, so they call it step Bernoulli. But here we have an infinite number of particles on both sides, and we don't know how to derive them. In fact, these formulas are new. In the two half Bernoulli case, there were no such formulas before. There's a famous paper by in the community by Corbin Sasamoto and Bordin Corbin Sasamoto, in which they have Bernoulli on one side and finite number of particles on the other. But here it's not finite. So, and the formula looks different. So it's quite different in fact. Okay. So yeah, so the game in this community of integrable probabilities is that you can use or take inspiration from integrability to get exact results for some interesting stochastic process.
Sorry, another question. What is the initial condition? T equals zero?
Rho plus on the right and rho minus.
In terms of tau to the power?
So it's not here, but it's hidden here. Theta plus is rho plus, and theta minus is rho minus. And when you want to check the initial condition at t equal to zero, because of these contours, whether x is positive or negative, you will take either your pole at plus one, minus one, or minus tau, and this will pop out to theta plus or theta minus, whether you're on the right or the left. It's in fact, checking the initial condition is simple. You just have to write, to look at the integrals. Okay, so duality, an exact solution for these tau correlators in finite number, thanks to better answers. Now, the problem is that, okay, we have a polygon formula with some nested contours, and we want to extract something from. So the game now is to denest the contours. Try to remove the contours one by one in this side. Here we cannot do much because there's an essential similarity at minus one, and this is not handy. You cannot handle it. But here you have only poles. Functions are meromorphic. So you can do the denesting. And this, in fact, is a crucial part in what, that's what we think in our work is the key point. So we have been able to denest the formula for the contours and to write it as a finite series in densities plus to the power k times some k integrals where the denesting makes some rational fractions in the variables z1 to zk appear. And by doing the combinatorics of this denesting, we notice that there is a nice recursion formula which allows you to compute recursively any of these rational functions starting from f0, 0 equal to 1, because as you can see it couples the kth term with the k minus 1, n minus 1. So in fact these rational functions, they form a kind of Pascal tableau, okay? Exactly like a triangle of Pascal, but of course they are more complicated than binomial numbers, because they are functions and they satisfy this kind of recursion. So by hand you can compute the first fews. We have not been able for general tau to disentangle them completely, but what happens is that for tau going to 1 in the symmetric limit, so we really want to compute the statistics of the heights over point x for any x at any time, and using this kind of formula, it's kind of, you know, it's just at the tau integers come an integral when tau goes to 1. By using this kind of formula, because we have a contour integral representation for this object, we can, after having done the denesting, we can take the tau going to 1 limit here, and more importantly here, and this recursion becomes a differential equation that we can solve. And in the end, what we obtain is an explicit formula for the end moment of this height variable in terms of some coefficients, m and k. Okay, we can compute them analytically if you want in terms of partitions, but the generating function of these coefficients is simple. Okay, times some integrals, these jk's, which depend on x and t, and these integrals are essentially the tau equal to 1 limit of the previous denested contour integrals. So we get a formula for the nth power of the height, so in fact whole statistics, because we can reconstruct by Laplace transform the probability distribution of n if we know all the moments. We get a formula for this in terms of kind of combinatorial coefficients times some integrals. And these integrals, and this is something which you know well of course, these integrals, by doing some massaging and some symmetrizations, they can be rewritten as a finite size determinant of the kernel I told you at the beginning. Okay. So, this is the integral at order k, it's a k by k determinant. Now, I go to the generating function, which contains all the moments, sum of lambda n over factorial n, n to the power n, and resumming everything makes my Fredon determinant pop out. So this gives us the master result. From which all
this
the rest
is a Fredon determinant with respect to this contour C0,
which is small enough to contain, not to contain any of the...
It's a circle around...
Not necessarily a circle, but it's a small contour.
Small contour.
Which does not contain any of the parts of this kernel function. Mm. Yeah. There are formulas for large contours too. Mm. And they don't look alike, and this is also okay in the community. Okay, so this is the result I told you about. We can go back to the tracer. You remember that the probability that the tracer has moved more than x is the same as the probability that the height over x is negative. In fact, more generally, once we have chosen the tracer at time t equal to 0 and put a tag on it, we can tag all the particles. Okay? Just respective to the tracer. Again, sorry for this bizarre convention, but it's useful. So we call x1, x2, the first particle to the left of the tracer, the second particle to the left, and x-1, the first particle to the right of the tracer. So now we have a labeling for all the particles, and the small reasoning I told you, I didn't tell you about, the fact that if you want a particle to move such a distance, it has to push all the particles between its initial position and its final position at time t away. In fact, you can deduce easily that the probability that the mth particle moves less than x is equal to the probability that the height over x is strictly bigger than m. And now, using the fact that we know everything about m, we can in fact deduce the position, the probability distribution of the position of any particle in the symmetric exclusion process in terms of the same formula. The one I gave you at the beginning was for m equal to 0. Okay, how much time do we still have?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, so some physics. So we'll try to draw some physical consequences of these forward-looking results to get some formulas, especially for large deviations and some fluctuating hydrodynamics. So we have an exact formula for the exponential generating function of the height, we can do some asymptotics at long times. So in the long time limit, by analyzing this Fredon determinant, it's usually quite difficult, but in this case it happens to be not very difficult. It's just applying the settle point method. You can prove that this exponential, this moment generating function for the height over x, behaves like exponential minus square root of t times the function mu psi lambda, and you see when you take the derivative with respect to lambda at any order, we generate the kth moment of n. So mu of lambda, we have to take the log first, mu of lambda and psi is a cumulant generating function of the variable n. This property is equivalent to the fact that the variable nxt satisfies the large deviation principle. For the aficionados, this is the so-called Gardner-Ellis theorem. So the fact that you have this is equivalent to say that you have a concentration of the probability of n, rescaled by square root of t. Usually, in normal cases, it's t, but here it's square root of t. And the speed of concentration of this probability is measured by this large deviation function, which depends not exactly on x, but on x or square root of t, which is xi, up to some size, factor 2, and on q. And this large deviation function for the height at point xi is related to this cumulant generating function by Legendre transform. I'm going very fast about all that because this is bread and butter for people doing non-equilibrium statistical mechanics. But if you want to prove it, just say that you have a representation of the probability distribution. So you can calculate the probability of having exponential n. So if you write it, you see that it's a Laplace transform of this object. And by doing saddle point, you see that this Laplace transform translates into a Legendre transform for the functions which are associated with it. So in particular, if we take q equal to 0, we see that phi of xi 0 is just the maximum value with respect to lambda of this function mu and xi lambda. So I didn't tell you what is this function mu of xi and lambda, but it's explicit by making asymptotic analysis of the freedom determinant. It has an explicit form, which is given here. So there is a kind of prefactor which looks like a polylog, which happens in many problems in this game. But this polylog is dressed by an R function, the integral of an R function. Okay, so it's again not a very highly transcendent function, only basic transcendent function. And there's an extra term which corresponds to the M0 factor, which was there to take into account the initial conditions on the left and on the right. So now that we know this cumulant generating function, by expanding with respect to the parameter lambda, we can get explicit formulas for the cumulant of the height at, in the large time limit at any wished order. We just have to do expansions on this function. This is not so difficult because A does not contain any lambda. Lambda is only an omega. So we just have to expand exponentials and add lambda. Okay, but we are not really interested in the height. The initial interest was in the tracer position. Again, this relation. Well, this relation, if you now use the fact that both the x variable and the height variable satisfy large deviation principle, this relation, if you look it right into the eyes, tells you that the large deviation function of the tracer is exactly the large deviation of the height, but for x equal to 0. So the large deviation function of the tracer, which is really the object we were interested in, its existence was proved, as I told you, by Setorama and Varadan 7 years ago. So this large deviation function of the tracer is evaluating the large deviation of the height at 0. And as I just wrote in the previous slide, this is just the maximum over lambda of the mu function, and the mu function, we have an explicit formula for it in terms of R functions in the series. Okay? So in fact, we have now a parametric formula for the large deviation function of the tracer. We cannot do better in most of the games, so we have only parametric formulas. By the way, because I just told you about the end on the particles, in fact, you could ask yourself, like, what is the physical meaning of this general large deviation function in terms of particles? Well, in fact, this large deviation function phi of xi and q is the large deviation function of the particle with label m given by m is equal to q square root of t. So if you take m finite, it will just behave like the tracer. And to get some different behavior, you had to go away from the tracer of the order of square root of t, which is natural, which is a scale, which is the dynamical scale of the problem. Okay, I promised you that it will be explicit a bit. So by using these formulas, by taking derivatives, take the simple case where the densities on the left and on the right are equal, while you retrieve the old Aratia result for the variance of the crystal. But you can also compute the fourth cumulant or the sixth cumulant and ask Mathematica to compute higher cumulants. So I just insist on the fact that even though these formulas may look formal, in the end you get numbers. 540 is a formal, it's a number. You can also plot, you can plot the large deviation function. The tracer analyze the wings, the tails, compare with free particles or reflecting Brownian motions, plenty of things you can do. You can also compute. So an interesting case is to start with two different densities and put your tracer in the middle. Okay? If you start with two different densities, suppose the densities on the right is bigger, this one is smaller, then of course your tracer will be pushed backwards, okay, because of the overshoot of densities. But the tracer will not move linearly with time. It will move as square root of time. So somehow, in the long time limit, you can talk about its speed, but it's not really a speed. The average position is square root of t times something. Let's call it speed, but it's not a speed. Okay? So you can compute that speed in terms of the mismatch between the left and the right and some simple integral of the air function. And it satisfies an equation. You can actually solve it explicitly, but you can plot anything you like using that. And you can also compute the variance of the tracer in the case we have two different densities on the right and on the left. So it's more fluctuating now because you have one more source of noise. And okay, things are rather explicit. One thing which is nice, as I showed you, is that, of course, if rho plus is equal to rho minus, the average speed, quote-unquote, of the tracer is zero. So, if rho is uniform, your tracer, of course, has no preference between left and right, but it fluctuates, and the quadratic fluctuations of the tracer are in square root of t. If rho plus is different from rho minus, your tracer moves, but it does not move linearly with time, it moves in square root of t. Okay? In the usual case of Brownian motion, if you have pure Brownian motion without external field, you have some diffusion constant. If you apply a small field to your charged Brownian particle, it will start to slide at a finite speed because of Stokes formula and so on. This is ancient calculation, and you will have a response. And we have this ancient relation between fluctuations at equilibrium and linear response when you apply a small field. The nice thing, and this was in fact known already a long time ago by Ferrari, Goldstein, and Leibovitz, is that even in this context where the scalings with respect to time are not normal ones, diffusion is anomalous, speed is anomalous, you still have the Einstein relation. Okay. And what you can show is that in fact the fact that this Einstein relation is true, it is true for a deeper reason, which is a symmetry of your large deviation function, which is a kind of Gravotti-Cohen symmetry. Again, another topic which is very, very fashionable and important in non-equilibrium statistical mechanics, is that the usual Einstein relation can be upgraded to a relation between large deviation functions, even if you're far from equilibrium. And here, you can prove explicitly that this relation is true, really, by using the explicit formula. And in particular, this relation, when rho plus and rho minus become infinitely close, shows that the Einstein relation is also true in this context, a fact which was already known by Pablo Ferrari, Goldstein, and Joe Leibovitz, long term. Another context where you can use the general formula, which was already solved by Derrida and Gershenfeld almost 10 years ago, is a special case where you pile up all particles to the left and nothing to the right, and you want to compute the statistics of the current qt, so the total number of particles on the right at a given t, time t, the last time limit. Derrida and Gershenfeld were able to compute the large deviation function for the current, cumulant generating function for the current, and in our notation this corresponds to mu, zero lambda, and we retrieve the result in this context. You can also go to another limit, I will maybe not talk too much about it, but suppose now you have a very small density of particles, rho plus and rho minus are very small. And you look at things in the long time limit. Of course, you will not see the mesh of the lattice anymore. So what you will have effectively are Brownian motions, which are constrained to reflect to each other and to keep their order. And in this context, you can do some ad hoc of initial calculations. And you can show that the calculation that you do for reflecting Brownian motions coincide with the low density limit of the general formula we have found. All these are, if you want, coherence checks. But it's no check, but okay. You need to check, but it works. And in the special case where you start with the Brownian particles on the left of your system and nothing to the right, and you leave them evolve, then you can see that the distribution of the rightmost particle is in fact nothing but the distribution of largest extreme eigenvalue, extreme value in Gaussian statistics. Because you have many Brownian motions which are computing, and you want to find the max of these Gaussian values at a given time. And the calculation was done by some teams have found it a long time ago, and you can retrieve it, and you find that, in fact, in that case, you have a super diffusive motion of your system in square root of t log t. Okay, we are almost finishing. Still have a few minutes.
One or two
transparents. Something different I want to tell you about to conclude. All this is full of combinatorics, patterns, that's beautiful mathematics, far from physics. What would a normal physicist do? He would say, okay, I'm looking at this system with particles which are diffusing, but the number of particles is conserved. He or she, preferably she, would write a conservation equation. So nothing is created or destroyed in the system. So you have a conservation equation where the variation of the density is the divergence of the current. And what is the current here? Well, there's a diffusion current, because particles diffuse. And there may be some noisy term, because the system is stochastic. So a normal physicist would write that on the back of the envelope, and he or she would put two coefficients here, a diffusion coefficient here, and something we would call the conductivity here. And the noise, if you think a little more about it, if you have a system of size L, the noise scales like 1 over L, the amplitude, the square amplitude of the noise. So somehow, a physical representation of your problem, forgetting about combinatorics, patterns, exclusion process, is just a fluid which satisfies a stochastic hydrodynamic equation. Okay. The only input you need for microscopics, and this has to be calculated, is the value of D, which is 1 for the exclusion process, and sigma, which is 2 rho 1 minus rho. This takes into account the exclusion for the exclusion process. For other models, you will have other formulas. And also, you have to remember that when L is big and we are in infinite system size, this noise becomes vanishingly small. So what would be the logical thing? You have a system with a very small noise. This stochastic hydrodynamic equation, you can write it as a path integral. And the noise measures h bar in your 1 over L is h bar in your path integral, and you are in the limit, in the semi-classical limit. So the dominant path in your stochastic problem will be the instantons of your of the action which corresponds to this hydrodynamic stochastic equation. So this is precisely what the Giordano-Lasagnos group in Rome has been working on for the last 10 or 15 years, the so-called macroscopic fluctuation theory, MFT. They have been able to prove things also. And they have been able to prove that in the continuous limit, the local current and the local density do satisfy a large deviation principle, functional large deviation principle, with an action that you can write in terms of the density, the current, and these two coefficients. So in a given path, the dominant paths, in a given problem, the dominant paths are stationary points of this action. So what you have to do, forget about that, is to solve the Euler-Lagrange equations for this action, these Laplace equations are coupled and non-linear, how to solve under the condition that your tracer has made an excursion of a given amplitude. So this cannot be solved, but you can solve perturbatively. And this is, in fact, something we did already 5 years ago. And using this fluctuating analytic approach, we were able quite easily to get the second moment, and after 60 pages of calculations, obtain the fourth cumulant. And then we were dead. There was no hope to get higher cumulants by using this perturbative approach, although in principle it could have been done. So now the last thing I want to emphasize is that this formula is in fact the same that the one I gave you 5-10 minutes ago using the Bethe-Lanz axiom. The exact solution, which is here, same formula. Okay. So this is a kind of check, not of Bethe-Lanz axiom combinatorics, but the fact that this physicist's approach using fluctuating hydrodynamics is really relevant even for some very precise observables as a position of a single particle and its fluctuations. And this was even beyond our hopes that MFT could really monitor a single particle in this fluid when you go to a continuous limit. But it's true, and you do get the exact fourth cumulant. So at least it has an heuristic, even though it's impossible to solve the equations to all orders from this approach, nobody knows how to do it for the moment being. It gives us some hint by looking at these formulas for the structure to guess in the case of the exact solution. In fact, MFT was helpful at the heuristic level to get the structure of the general formula. Okay, we're going to end here. This is just a dynamic picture of what happens to the system when the tracer moves in fluid. Again, the hydrodynamic limit, the average hydrodynamic, no fluctuations here. And I want to conclude. I hope I gave you a kind of detailed procedure to understand how integral probability work on a given problem. But there are many, many problems which have been addressed and are addressed nowadays by using these techniques. Finally, the result we get for the last large deviation function is rather simple, so we may wonder if there is some simpler derivation. Of course, some other initial conditions, but only a finite number of them, can also be treated. So this is something we or other people may think about. Can we generalize to quench and yield to some other initial conditions? And finally, maybe more interesting to statistical physicists, we are intrigued by the fact that MFT were really somehow helpful, although we could not solve it. And to conclude a bit like Silva, there may be some classical integrability hidden in MFT that we have not been able to guess or to track down for the moment being. Thank you very much.
Please, thank you for a few short questions.
Yes, you mentioned this result by Derrida and Gershenfeld, I mean, which is a special case of very nice result. If I remember well, I mean, they used the standard patterns, that's not what you to do that, the technology, the sophisticated one that you use.
In fact, no, they did not really use standard patterns.
How did they do that?
No, so they used, So this is a special configuration. So I lied a bit. When I said that duality does not work for ZEV, it does work for ZEV in some special limit. For example, if you take the correlators not of the height, but of the occupation variables, they satisfy the duality equation. In fact, ZEV is circular, but not for the n variables, but for the tau variables, the eta variables, which are the local binary variables. So in fact, so it's, if you want from spirit, it's a similar. They wrote the evolution equations for density correlators, eta is x1t, eta x2t, eta xkt, and they satisfy the same dynamical equations as the finite symmetric exclusion process. Then we use the standard Bethe-Lanz.
Right.
Okay, which is in fact hidden here too. But in fact, they use some formulas of Tracy and Widow. And this tandem patterns us by combinatorics, you have a sum of factorial n symmetries. By using some symmetrization of the integral and so on, so they were able to reduce it to a determinant. And their identities are, in fact, the ones which were used in Hasselbaum and that we use also in our case. But, for example, in that case, they were able to compute the current here for this initial condition. But if you start with Bernoulli, and again, you can't ignore the detail, if you start with Bernoulli on both sides, and you want to compute the current somewhere else, so n, x, t, for x, or just four, you cannot use that method. In fact, if you try to use duality only for z, for pure z, you don't get closed equations for these correlators, and it's a moose, to call it. Mm-hmm. And you have to go to az. With this tau, use this tau moment, then use this reduction formula which allows to you to write from tau moments to real moments, 1 minus tau to the power n, or 1 minus tau into. But of course, there's always the hope that we could do that in a simpler way. Maybe you will find it, but Tomoyo, Takashi, and me, we couldn't.
Short question? How do you get the transport coefficient for your object in the Hadoop?
So these transport coefficients, for Z, they are in fact well known, and there is a lot of different models for which you can compute them. First of all, they are not independent. There's only one of them. They satisfy Einstein relation. So if you know one of them, you know the other one. And, it's a whole, I mean, so this is so, I don't even know, it's so simple, d equal to 1. Either you can say that you just see that the hydrodynamic limit of Z is the heat equation, d equal to 1. Or if you want to invoke something more general, and it can be helpful in other models, Z, but not AZ, Z is the so-called gradient model, which means that the local current in the microscopic model is in fact the difference between two local functions. And for gradient models, you have the Green-Kumo formula simplifies and you can compute things explicitly. So if you really want to do a ab initio, use the fact that you have a gradient model and then apply it to Z.
I think we have to move to the next speaker, and we can thank Kirone.